Computer, here we go. Okay, we are recording and we're ready to start. The next announcement that I want to make sure that everybody hears is that usually at this event we would be passing out the big giant packet of papers for everyone to take and to have for your bulletin boards and your bulletin inserts, and have the big stack of camp brochures and the stack of staff packets and all the things, all the good as gold packets, copies of the good as gold forms. We will have printed packets of everything, and they'll just be the same packet will be in every envelope, and we'll have three or four different places that you can just pick those up. And then whoever needs one mailed to them or to their congregation will do that. But that'll be after March 31st. Okay. So the best first opportunity to pick up your packet is to attend our April 3rd, spring volunteer work day. Come rake some leaves and split some firewood and then pick up your packet. Or you could just come pick up your packet and leave. So we will be sending, and we will have packets of all printed materials available. Part of the reason is we haven't finalized our summer camp brochure. We haven't finalized our staff packet and such. And we haven't even created a summer camp postcard yet, because all the information has been changing and updating. You can pick up that packet at any point you come to the camp office too. We'll have packet pickups at the district office there on Plantation Road, and we'll also have packet pickups here and maybe a couple other convenient locations throughout the district. Okay. All right. So before we jump into me sharing my screen and a lot of the documents and the website and such, I do want to give you just sort of an update about the year in review for 2020. Even though it hurts me to have to go back in time to the year 2020 and think about it, you do need to know that, we're still here. Okay. The lights are still on at Camp Bethel. We are still employed. We are actually still employed full time and not cutting back to half time like Brethren Woods has had to do. We survived 2020 financially. The stinker was that we weren't able to do what we're built and what we're called to do. And that is to first and foremost have our summer camp ministry. And then secondly, having a ministry of hospitality and events. We were able to have some families and some groups here. We were able to host a couple of events. Our 5K was a big success. It was the best 5K we've ever had. People really relished the opportunity to get outside. And those of you who were present for that saw that we did the best we could with the safety mitigations and wave starts, but it raised the most money and had the most participants that we've ever had for our 5K. Our golf tournament was moved to September, and that was the best one we've ever had either, mostly through gifts and sponsorships, but great participation. And it was a great day too. Of course, the weather always helps when it's a beautiful weather. And we did the meal a little differently, which is probably something that we'll continue because it received a lot of good feedback and made the best use of people's time. Our Sounds of the Mountains event last April, remember it was April 3 and 4 was supposed to be the in-person event. We were one of the first kind of concerts or events that went to an all virtual event. And we're happy to say that we benefited from the novelty of that way back in the spring, and that the Sounds of the Mountains Festival, where it would usually be, you know, an in-person event, making a lot of money on the food sales and all the things that go on with that. The Sounds of the Mountains Festival really did very well, and people really opened their wallets for us and donated for that online festival last year. So we survived the year, meaning that we were able to add to our financial reserve last year. We did not lose money last year. We needed to add to our financial reserve in order to get through the first several months of this year and potentially the entirety of this year. So it's a good thing that we were able to build up some reserve, or else we would maybe be closing our doors last month. So we have enough money right now in order to keep folks employed, keep the lights on, and continue to do what we're doing through at least June at this point. Depending on summer camp registrations and things kind of picking back up with guest groups, and depending on people's gifts, we hope to survive 2021. We really only survived 2020 through those good fundraisers, fantastic outpouring of individual and congregational and group extra giving over and above self-allocations. And then also we were very fortunate as a district to receive the PPP loan. And we also got, and we were covered for, and I'll have to look into it if we can do this claim again this year, but we got an insurance claim for loss of income due to shutdown by civil authority last year. And that was a $37,000 insurance payout. We could have claimed a couple hundred thousand dollars. So we survived 2020. For 2021, we are going to continue to depend on gifts, because our sales, if you want to call them our sales, our summer camp, our guest groups, our rentals, will not keep pace with what our expenses would be. And already, this first quarter of 2021 is the thinnest quarter we've ever had, because there are literally like zero, well, not zero. There's like one or two little tiny, like little family groups that are here, where usually we would have guest groups, some large guest groups, just about every weekend here at the camp making rentals, which is the way that we kind of generate income to help us afford our summer camp ministry. So the whole, as is for everybody, the income model and the year last year was just upside down. We are grateful. We are thankful. We are blessed. We're inspired by the kind of giving that happened. And it's necessary to say that we're going to depend on that again in 2021. And so everybody on our mailing list will be getting another ask letter and update that all of you got a couple of those last year, and those will be going out before the end of the month also. So the year in review, 2020. The novelty of those fundraisers, like the free online Sounds of the Mountains, probably will not be as big a response this year, unless we just, promote the heck out of it, which we'll try to do. Okay. We're going to now move into sort of a series of topics. And let me just tell you what the topics are going to be in order. We're going to talk first and foremost about our plans for summer camp, the logistics first. The second big topic is our health and safety modifications in the era of COVID for summer camp, which could take up this entire meeting. And certainly could, but that's going to be a topic that we discuss. The next one is going to be talking briefly about our upcoming events and fundraisers. We're going to talk about our current needs and our current projects and opportunities to help with that. And then we'll wrap up with just like general information, our news, and then have a Q&A time at the end. Okay. All right. And I'm going to start doing a thing called screen sharing. And hopefully it doesn't eliminate the ability for you to look at each other's lovely faces. So I am going to now share a screen, and I'm gonna this hopefully is going to be a familiar view for you. This is the Camp Bethel website. Okay, so if you go to campbethelvirginia.org, you get our website, and I see that our internet is choosing to take quite a long time, but here's our Camp Bethel website. And of course, if you go over to, and I'm going to have to move my little people window out of my way so I can see it. But if you want to get to the camp reps webpage of the website, and you can follow along at home if you want to, if you have a second window open on your computer. But the way to get to our reps website is either to go to Connect, and you can scroll down to Camp Reps, okay? or you can just go right up here in the URL and hit a slash REP. Okay. However you want to do it. And that rep shortcut will take you, or the camp reps will take you to our camp representative page, and it turns into camp-reps.html. And so here's our camp rep page. And I spent quite a bit of time on this week, getting it ready and getting it more organized than it was. If you looked at it early in the week, you thought, what a jumble mess. But I have organized it this morning in a way that is just straight down what our agenda is, if you will. Okay. And there is a PDF posted of our meeting agenda. If you want to see, I'm pointing it out with my little circle thing. So if you want to follow along on like an agenda, you can do that. But we're gonna start here with our summer camps and our summer staff information. And there are links. And often when it's a web page, it'll say it's going to take you to the web page. And when it's a form, it'll say it'll take you to a form. Okay. Our summer camps this summer, and I'm just going to click right here on the web page and take us to our summer camps. First and foremost, we get to have summer camp this summer. In 2020 in the state of Virginia, summer camps were the only business industry that was not allowed to open under the phase 3 reopening guidelines in the state of Virginia. And so we, as Camp Bethel, having such a great support network and donors and fundraisers and our ability to open to families, were able to survive. There's a lot of camps that really, really struggled last year. So we're very happy that the governor has announced and that the state is moving and that the ACA has created guidelines and that the CDC has put out information and that all these groups are collaborating together to create plans for the ability to safely reopen. And partly from over 3,000 camps across the country in states that were not Virginia that did open last summer and did so safely and by following certain guidelines. And so we've also been able to take those lessons learned from all those camps and all that research data and all that stuff and be able to apply it to this summer. If you're familiar with our usual summer camp schedule, you'll notice that there are some gaps, first and foremost. The first gap that is visible is that there is not a column for family fun days or family outings. And the biggest glaring gap there is no parent-child overnight camp. And I see Trish shaking her head in despair. We're really saddened about that. But in looking at what we have to do, and we'll show you a little bit about what our health plan is and kind of what the mandatory requirements and things are. There was just really no way to, first of all, be able to have so many parent and children from so many different households, unless they occupied a single cabin on their own, but then how you did activities and then how that exposed our staff and then food and just the whole gamut. And so we looked into maybe a day program and we recognized that it kind of just introduced the same similar risks as an overnight program would. It would be too hard of a workaround. And a lot of other camps that we follow that we respect a lot too, we're having to make those same kind of decisions. So not the easiest decision. And I'll say that, you know, there might be still a percentage chance that we're able to figure it out. If things change, if things adapt, we might be able to. We kind of have to plan in one direction and that's forward. And so we're already planning for that not to happen. But again, we're keeping an open mind of the possibility of that. So that's the first big gap. The other big gap that you'll see is that it's a thinner schedule than what we have done in the past. Fewer options, fewer programs, fewer off-campus outings for like adventure days, and the off-campus outings that we are doing are limited in scope and size and distance. So we're not able to do as much of the trip camping where there's longer vehicle rides Although those where we do have a couple trips like backpacking, that'll be just that cohort. The New River trip, we take them and put them at the river and they don't come back for 4 days. And so there are some workarounds within it, but it gets pretty complex. But we're happy to be able to offer 7 weeks of programming. And you might say, well, you know, why are you doing 7 weeks? You're going to have fewer people sign up. And we know that we're going to have fewer people sign up, but we also know that we're cutting our capacity by half. So we're already limiting our capacity each week. And we thought, okay, so if we have half the people signing up, but we're cutting our capacity by half, then we still need to use all those weeks. And some of our camp schedule is also tied into what happens later in the summer when we have some of our guest camps come in. So for example, week 7, July 25 through 30, we do have tentatively the William Byrd High School band camp returning for their band camp, which is important income for us to be able to offer our summer camp. And we hope that that continues. And then actually after July into August, we do currently have scheduled the Salem High School band camp. We hope that that continues to be able for them to happen. Okay. On the summer camp page, you've got that schedule as an image, but then as you scroll down, there's some very basic COVID information with some links to the ACA field guide, as well as our own health and safety plan. And then you get down into the week by week listings. And this is how people can learn about each program and can register for each program and see the pricing for each program. For example, if we want to see the elementary resident program, we can click right on elementary resident one. My computer is going to take a while to load, but it takes you right to our elementary resident camps. A little slideshow of pictures is there. Hey, that's a familiar looking face. He was in the paper yesterday. That's Eli Chapman right there, I do believe, the great builder of tiny house. Elementary resident camp shows you what weeks are available, the pricing, and then how to register, and then the place where you go ahead and register. The description of why we do three prices. We do have a tiered price program that we've had in place for about 4 years now, which works really well. People ask, is there a discount for camp? We say, yes, our discount is right up in front. It's our subsidized fee. And so if you need a discount, our subsidized fee is available to you. And we are, just so you know, we do have a no risk policy. We had it last year too. And this year, again, we have a no risk policy for cancellations or late arrivals or for early departure. Is that we, you know, if folks choose not to come at the last minute, or their family is exposed at the last minute, or whatever, that people can credit their payments to another program. They can credit it to 2022. They can donate part or all of their fee, or they can also get a full refund. As long as we know at least 24 hours in advance, if they're not coming, we can provide that refund. But the trick is that that's occupied a spot in an already limited capacity camp. So if they just don't show up, we really, our options are limited, and we have to do that on a case by case basis. Okay. So summer camp, all the information's there. We will be doing a modified print brochure with descriptions and prices. I want to show you back at the camp reps page, a very handy dandy schedule with fees. So in the green chart here on the camp reps webpage, there's 2021 summer camp schedule and fees. And that's as a PDF. So you can print it and have copies of it if you need to, but it's our schedule on one side, kind of done in with no big giant color background. And then on page 2 is a chart with all the programs that we're offering and what the different fees are for that program. And we know that that is a very, that's kind of, you know, that's going to be a good resource for you, especially if you're organizing good as gold monies for this year. Okay. So you got your subsidized fee, your supporters fee, and your sustainers fee. And if you're wondering, the subsidized fee again is the lowest fee. It's the discounted fee. It's not what it actually costs to charge camp, but it's what we can do because we have all these fundraisers and all these rentals and all these gifts throughout the year. We can keep our prices low, generally lower than most other camps that provide what we provide comparably, 16 full meals, 5 nights of camp, and the kind of care and programming that we offer. The supporters fee is the actual cost of camp, which is generally $50 more than the subsidized fee. And then the sustainers fee is what we call the actual cost of camp plus a $50 gift. So for example, if it's a $230 subsidized fee, then it's a $280 supporters fee and a $330 sustainers fee. And anybody who chooses the sustainers fee does get a tax letter by the end of the year showing that they did give a gift to a charitable organization. And we really appreciate that. And a lot of folks give each year and help us in that way, especially this year. And I intend to change the language. And Jenna and Spencer remind me to do this in our fee language, in that those gifts that people who choose the supporters fee this year especially are going to go to buying a lot of the things that we need to buy for COVID safety in summer camp 2021. And we'll talk about those a little bit in a minute. So this is a good resource right there on the webpage, the summer camp schedule and the list of fees right there. And again, those fees are on each website, on each page of each camp and available for you. Let's talk real quickly about the Good as Gold program. And you'll see that there's a box here with the Good as Gold webpage and also our Good as Gold forms. Let's go to the Good as Gold webpage first and talk about that real briefly. A lot of congregations participate in the Good as Gold program, basically where they as a congregation are paying for their kids to come to camp, either in full or in part. And so we do have the Good as Gold page. And if you want to just right there on your URL, it's campbethelvirginia.org/gag, Good as Gold. Don't gag when you type that in, because you might have to clean the screen. So the Good as Gold program, it describes it. And this is a place where families who are getting Good as Gold can also register online, knowing that they're getting Good as Gold. So this is sort of the portal. If a family in your church is receiving, say, you know, $100 worth of Good as Gold from your congregation, instead of going through our general registration, which is going to prompt them like, hey, you owe us this, have them go through this portal right here in order to register. And then also on this page is a link to our 2021 Good as Gold instruction and forms for camp reps and pastors. Okay. So your forms are linked here for you to be able to print out those forms and instructions and, you know, the actual Good as Gold little check slip if you still do that. Okay. So it's all right there. The instructions are pretty, and let's see if it works. Let's should be a PDF. Let's hope it works. Let's hope it's the most updated form. Let's see if Spencer succeeded. See if we can give Spencer a pat on the back for. He did it. He did great, didn't he? Good job, Spencer. Well done, man. Well done. So here's your Good as Gold instructions, forms. It's all there. It tells you how to do it. Gives you all the options, Q&A. It's all there, okay? Sample form, frequently asked questions. It even walks you through how to do it on the website, okay? Has little images there on the website of how to do it. And the itemized camper list to print out, and then the actual forms that you can print out, okay? And kicks and giggles, and this opened in a separate window, and now I'm struggling to get this. I can't get to the top of my window because the Zoom thing is up there. How do I do that, Jenna? I guess I can minimize.
Did you? You may have to exit the screen share. There it is. There it is.
Well, that I need to get to the, I don't know what I can do. I go down here and then can, well, no, I don't want to close my whole Chrome.
Where would you like
to I just go? Wanted to go back to here and be able to show people how to navigate to the Good as Gold page from anywhere on our website, the homepage, wherever. You hover on camps, and then you scroll down to Verlina Church's Good as Gold, and that's how it's going to take you to the Good as Gold page. Or you can again type campbethelvirginia.org/gag Good as Gold. Okay. We also have a program at camp, a campership program that that we have a fund, that Camp Bethel itself has a fund, and then has an escrow fund also, where we, at least when I inherited this position back in 2002, the language was, we have never turned any child or family away because they couldn't afford summer camp. And I'm proud to continue that tradition. Here at camp, we have a very healthy campership program. And so we have forms as well as an online capability for that. But let me show you first on the reps page. So we're here at the reps page, okay, camp reps. And then you'll see that we have the campership information form and web page, and then also the PDF, okay, the printable PDF. And so the web page you can get there by here. You can also get there by going to About or Camps, either one, and go to Parent Info, and then it's Financial Assistance, okay? And that's going to take you to our campership financial assistance application page, which if you do a URL, it's campbethelvirginia.org/help. Okay. And this describes it. We have adapted it a little bit this year, and we're going to see how this works, but there's been a lot of confusion over the years as to what constitutes eligibility for the campership program. And I want to actually float this out here to you as the camp representatives, and let you know too that in general, it has always been an honor system program where we have the family, you know, expresses a need, and we have a pastor, a school guidance counselor, a social worker, or an agency worker to just verify and say, yes, this family has a need. Not saying, oh, this family makes this much money or this family does that. We are aware, painfully aware, that some families have taken advantage of our program before. And some families just don't understand that they're not poor or that they don't have a need. So we've basically had an epiphany this year when asked some other camps of what they do of you know, what kind of qualifies you for this. And so we've put a chart on here, which is based on two things. It's based on the HHS, Health and Human Services, poverty levels for 2021, based on your maximum household adjusted gross income for the number of people you have in your home, times the 1.85, which is the maximum to receive reduced school lunch, which would also be not free school lunch, but reduced school lunch in the state of Virginia. So for example, my family is four people in the house, and that 49,025, we as a family make a little bit more than that as a combined family income. So I would not be eligible for reduced school lunch. And that's a good basis to kind of get a sense of like whether or not I really need a campership. We do direct families if they need help, and you know, if they have a specific situation, oh, we had, you know, big medical bills this year, or we had a death in the family, or this is a situation, like it's always kind of a case by case. But we want to let you know that we've done that. And I look for your feedback, whether you think like we should abandon that and just go on people's word, or there should be some proposed guidance for folks to be able to kind of get a sense of like, of this. Okay. So this is sort of something new that we've done this year. It has not yet slowed down the process or slowed down the requests for camperships. So, Jenna, are there any questions popping up right now about this? There's an online campership financial application that the social worker, the pastor, social worker, agency worker, or school guidance counselor are to fill out for that family. And there's a, you know, some instructions that says, make sure you know what camp they're choosing, make sure you know how much that cost, et cetera, et cetera. There is also a printable form for families to be able to print out an application form to do that. And if folks can call to them, we'll mail them forms to them too, if necessary. Okay. Okay, so that's the campership program that we do. All right, the next thing I'd like to show you as part of our summer camp 2021 is our summer camp staff information. And of course you can get to it through the reps page, but you can also get through it straight to our website. And of course we can also mail printed information to you. I bet if Barbara Hartzell is currently listening on a landline, she's getting frustrated at me referring to the website a lot. Sorry, Barbara, we'll mail you printed copies of everything. But we do have our summer staff page, which if you click on it from here, it takes you straight to it. And the URL, of course, is campbethelvirginia.org/summer-staff. And it has our summer staff applications. It has a nifty little video loop there. We should do that on more of our web pages, by the way. I figured out how to do that a few years ago, and now I can't replicate the trick. So it has all the information about counselors and the needs that we have, including kitchen and grounds work. And we do have kitchen positions open. This summer, we are right now, we're saying that we're unable to have weekly or like on-site overnight volunteers. We're still going to need volunteers as part of our Sunday check-in process. But in terms of like the usual kind of week-long volunteers, again, it introduces kind of a, we might have a process if the volunteers are willing to jump through all the same hoops that our staff and our camper families are going to have to jump through, which includes a 14-day pre-screening and all the business otherwise. So as of right now, we're kind of putting the brakes on volunteers, but we know that we need to keep thinking about that. And that's something that continues to adapt. Okay. The main thing we need help from you as our camp representatives and supporters is we need senior counselors. Okay. We need senior counselors. And when I say senior counselors, I mean 18 years and older. We need senior counselors. We are hiring junior counselors who are ages 16 or 17 and preferably have some experience at Camp Bethel or in your church or, you know, are known to be good leaders. Camp Bethel is not the place that you send troubled 21-year-olds living in mom's basement who have no direction in life. And a summer at camp would be good and shake them out of there, whatever. Okay. That's really not what we can do, especially this summer. We know that that's true, that a lot of duds like me, when we were 19 years old, went to camp and really found ourselves and, you know, really bloomed. But that was a different time. This summer, especially with COVID and all the safety mitigations that we're having to, follow, we need really reliable, resilient, strong, capable leaders as our counselors. Okay. And all the information is there, and I'm not going to click through and show you all that. Okay. The last thing I want to talk about in terms of this coming summer, before we talk about all the COVID health and safety, because we are going to talk about all that, is our staff adoption. Our staff adoption program that we started last year and then had to kind of change because we didn't have camp last year. So we do have links to the staff adoption page and also a PDF of the information, which will be sent to you. Whoa, that is not what was supposed to happen. Yeah, okay. I'll have to fix that link later on today because that was not correct. So again, campbethelvirginia.org, and we make it simple. You type adopt. And no, this is not adopt one of the many cats and dogs who get dropped at the end of the Bethel Road. This is adopt one of the many humans who drops themselves at the end of Bethel Road for a summer. This is our summer staff adoption page. Last year, the plan was to do, we have prayer groups each summer, six staff in a prayer group, and they are kind of, you know, touchstones for each other all summer long. They do weekend stuff together. They meet together. They pray together. They're the deeper connection. And a lot of those prayer groups continue years and years and years, after the summer, with friendships and Snapchat inside jokes and all the things. This summer, we're not able to do those prayer groups because we're going to be discouraging that kind of group, not group camaraderie, but group being close to each other and riding all, you know, packing five people into one car, those kind of things. So the staff adoption this summer is going to be, we're just asking for individual adoptions. And so if your congregation or you as a family or as an organization can adopt one or more, the idea is it's $100 per adoptee. And that also includes, you know, letters back and forth, maybe a care package. We hope that our staff can attend church with you, maybe by Zooming in, or if you have parking lot church going on. You know, somehow, if depending on what's happening at your congregation, that they would be able to attend worship with you, possibly on or around June the, is that the 5th, Jenna? That Sunday, whatever that Sunday is, around then, or, you know, streaming in potentially somehow. You know, that staff person or those, that group of staff people acknowledging and kind of connecting with you as a congregation, and then also that congregation kind of raising prayer for the staff people and the staff people reciprocating for your congregation. And then that $100 is an end of the summer bonus. And that does a couple of things. First of all, it rewards these folks for, wow, you know, what a summer, what a hard summer to have been on staff and all the things that we're having to do. And if they make it through the summer, they deserve that. But it also helps us in the recruiting process in order to say, you know, here's your contracted weekly pay and you work through your contract or you work through your agreement for the summer. And at the end of the summer, you get another $100 as part of your staff adoption program. So it's all there on the website. You know, there's an inquiry form that you can fill out if you want to learn more. You can just donate directly to it through our donate button, which has an option in the PayPal thing where you want to give to staff adoption. And then there's also an actual form a PDF describing all this, very similar to this website. So the staff adoption program. For those congregations and groups that gave money last year to the staff adoption program, first of all, thank you very much. You also have probably noticed that you didn't get that money back. and that's because we put all that money into our campership program. And then that transferred at the end of the year over to the campership fund escrow. And so that money is still scholarship money. Let us know individually as a group or congregation if you have issues or questions about that, given that you gave the money for the staff adoption, which is a semi-scholarship program, but then the money was unable to be used specifically for that. So just let us know. And that's a letter that I should have sent months ago to you. Okay, I am now going to head back over to the rep page. Rep, and get back to our camp rep page, and we'll get through some of this safety information. Are there any questions before we get into the safety information in general about summer camp, summer staff? Just knowing that all the majority of your advanced questions when you registered for this Zoom call were, how are you going to keep people safe and what are you going to be doing? And so we're about to jump into that. So before we jump into that, are there any questions, Jenna, that are popping up in the chat?
There are questions, but I am addressing them, so you're fine. Keep going.
Okay, great, great, good. Are you addressing them to everybody or just to the individuals?
Just to the individuals, everyone if necessary.
Okay, gotcha, gotcha, yeah. If it's, yeah, if folks are okay with it being to everyone, they can ask it to everyone. Okay, we're now going to, I got to end this share and take a gander at everybody's happy face again. And we're going to jump into the safety for our the safety for this summer, at least the plans as they are happening right now, or as we are attempting to have them happen right now. So on your rep webpage, you get down past the green chart and you get to the blue chart here, COVID-19 health plans and information for 2021. There's a lot of information. Our actual living document, ever-evolving health plan, the summary slides, which we're going to look at in just a minute, the stuff from the state of Virginia, from the whole phase 3 reopening guidelines, just the summer camp part. Maybe the most important link, our ACA field guide for implementation of CDC guidance for summer camps, which is our number one resource for the things that we're doing and attempting. And then there's some other information here, including a link to a video about building DIY box fan air filters. I'm going to show you a couple images from that in just a minute. What we give to our guest groups. And then there are recorded webinars that we'd love for you to watch about camp and COVID, what we do know and don't know from Dr. Laurie Brown. And then a fantastic one from Dr. Tracy Gaslin about camping and COVID times, effective health and wellness measures. Boy, if we could clone Tracy Gaslin and have one of her at every camp across the country, it would be fantastic. Yeah, I know. I don't know if that's going to be possible, Jenna. But anyway, this is a great video to watch if you want to see what other camps did and kind of the approach that ACA is taking. Just know that this webinar was recorded in January, and as you know, things continue to change. And then also a fun little, if you haven't seen our little announcement video with Governor Northam announcing that summer camps would open, and then the real footage of reaction across the globe that happened as soon as he announced it. That's a joke, but anyway, that's our fun little video. We're going to spend some time this morning just in our health plan summary slides. So you can look at them here, but I am going to share the screen. And it's the PowerPoint that I have here. So we're going to do that here in just a second. Appreciate you hanging in there. We are going to take a purposeful stretch break here in just a little bit so that if you have to jet, you can jet. Okay, so let's take a look here at this and our... All right. Our summer camp health plan. Jenna, am I successfully sharing my screen? Okay. So this is just a summary, and I'm going to try to just snowplow through it. This is not the detailed health plan. This is just kind of summary slides to give you a sense of all the things that we're considering and adapting. Okay. So the first thing you need to know is that, I got to be careful with my clicking. That the health plan, the way we're approaching it, the way we're approaching summer camp, the way we approach everything that's happening on site right now is that we are assuming that all participants, staff, and visitors are contagious. Now we know that that's not the case, right? But we're implementing practices that assume that everybody is contagious. And that the virus shed, which I've heard that, which just sounds really gross when you think about shedding virus, that the virus shed is everywhere. And so that we have to be extra careful. So that's first and foremost, that's the way. Now we wanna make sure that we're not treating people like they are hazardous waste, okay? You know, we're not putting on hazmat suits and like being like, get away from, you know. So that's with Christian love and brethren service and, you know, agape. But we are assuming that we are all potentially contagious. Okay. And so you'll see that kind of throughout the plan of why we're of how we're doing it. Okay. And our health plan will adapt and update as information improves and as conditions evolve. And that means evolve either for the better or evolve for the worse. Let's hope it continues to be better. Shame on the governor of Texas and Mississippi. Okay. So let's hope conditions continue to improve. But as information, you know, information continues to change. So the health plan will change and update. So it is not set in stone. This is really important because some folks in camping have just kind of parked themselves right in July of 2020. And so much has changed since then that you have to be, first of all, you have to educate yourself on what's going on. And the ACA plan and the Virginia mandates and things are very up to date. And we feel real good about leaning on those for a lot of our information. Okay. These are the 9 slides we're gonna hit. And so the first one is that, just so you know, our reopening guidelines are, we're not inventing them ourselves, thank goodness. But we are, first and foremost, it's what the CDC puts out. And then from there, what Virginia allows and recommends, and that of course is funneled through the Virginia Department of Health. We're very blessed here in Botetourt County with a real helpful health department and a real nice guy who is a good teacher for us. His name is Robert Bobby Bernier. And I think that's French. So we get along well because I'm French, you know. And then the ACA, the American Camp Association, working with Environmental Health and Engineering Incorporated, have created this very detailed field guide, which continues to update. And it's in its third iteration at this point. It updated at the end of January based on the CDC guidelines. Okay. And it's everything from transportation to lodging to food service to healthcare to pre-screen, all of it. It's all in there. Okay. And so our plan is based on these guidelines and these plans. The first part that kind of impacts things the most is this 50% lodging capacity. In figuring out sort of distance and how many, the hardest part is lodging, is overnight lodging, because we're not going to be wearing masks in bed. Okay. So how do you have what would typically be 14 human beings crammed into a cabin, you know, with 7 sets of bunk beds? How do you alter that and keep distance and kind of know that we can, what's one thing that we can do automatically kind of across the board that helps to mitigate that risk? And that's cut our lodging capacity by 50%. Okay. So instead of a cabin, and this is a little image of Wildwood cabin, the layout of Wildwood cabin, which I think Wildwood actually has like 15 beds, like 14 bunks and one single, but we're maximizing our cabins that would typically have 14 at 7. And then we have a couple cabins that only have 12. Those are going to be 6. Our open air platforms in our adventure village could probably be maximum 8 to 10, because A, they're a little bigger, and B, you've got the open air. But that reduces the overall on-site population by about 40%. And I say it's not 50%, it's 40%, because we're considering for staff, the staff isn't cut in half, and the adventure villages aren't necessarily exactly cut in half. But if you know about our program, we do units, that we group the kids into units, and where we would, and during a full week of maximum capacity, using every, you know, all 4 rooms of Heritage's cabins and all the cabins and cottages and bunk rooms, you know, we could have anywhere like 18 units of campers. So our maximum units of campers is only going to be like maximum 8 or 9 units doing the activities of camp and moving through the campus. Okay. So that is, you know, so imagine that, first of all, that the population is generally reduced by about 40%. Okay. That then causes a staff restructure. And I know this is a terrible image with a bunch of X's for positions, but it's what I came up with this past Monday getting ready for the Northern Area Ministers meeting. But the staff restructure at camp, we typically have had activity leaders who are specialists, if you will. We've had a crafts coordinator. We've had two or three high ropes course coordinators who do nothing but high ropes. We have a pool coordinator who's also our lifeguard but does the pool stuff. We've had a two trips coordinators who coordinate all the offsite trips and adventures and are the drivers. We've had a digital media person who does all of our, you know, photos and videos and those kind of things. We've had a spiritual life coordinator who works with the chaplains and leads, you know, Bible studies and worship with the chaplains. We're eliminating the majority of those, and each unit will have one unit coordinator who also serves as a counselor, but is that coordinator who, first of all, is trained in all the specialty activities, the majority of the specialty activities, but then is also the behind the scenes person. Hey group, all right, unit, I'm going to the craft house to get things ready to make sure sanitation is prepped, da 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 da. And then the unit shows up, and then the coordinator's like, okay, y'all are heading over to, you know, the pool area because we're scheduled to be at the pool because we're the only unit that can be at the pool during that time. I'll be here wrapping up and wiping down the surfaces and sanitizing. I'll catch up in 5 minutes. Or that's the person who sanitizes the archery equipment before and after the group is there. And that person is also kind of the overall COVID risk mitigator of that unit, kind of overseeing the health and sanitation practices and ensuring that that it happens. What that does is that creates a change in the overall number of staff. So each unit is going to have three counselors, really four counselors, but one of those counselors is a unit coordinator. Okay. And whether that's a male or female then changes the male female count of the other three. So every boys cabin, for example, will have a maximum of five campers and then two male counselors for a total of seven. If it's a cabin that only houses 12, it'll be four campers and two male counselors. Okay. All right. This is not very many words for what will probably be the longest and one of the more difficult parts of what we're doing, but that there will be pre-camp screening, 14-day pre-camp screening. Those of you who have kids in public school know exactly what this is. It's basically a form that you fill out and you agree and you limit exposure and you're doing temperature checks and things like that prior to camp coming. It's an honor system thing, but the biggest thing I think is to raise awareness and for families to be careful. There will also be modified check-in and check-out. There will be screening at check-in, and there will be daily health screening for everybody at camp. And then the modified check-in and check-out, if you've done check-in at Camp Bethel on a regular week of camp, you know that we all gather in the gym and start things at 4 o'clock, and sometimes there's 300, 400 human beings packed in there. Well, that won't be happening this year. Each unit will be assigned in advance. Each family will be assigned in advance their check-in time and their check-in location. And they will move their children directly into their lodging. We have yet to figure out how we're going to do the adventure villages. Probably be like under a shelter, and then we'll truck the luggage out there, something like that. So there'll be check-in pretty much happening from probably like 1:30 in the afternoon on Sunday all the way through and right up until dinner at 5:30 on Sunday with the staggered check-ins and the modified check-in. Same thing for check-out. That eliminates one of my favorite parts of camp, and that is the big closing picnic on Friday evening at dinner with all the families coming and just the big hoopla and the celebration. The campers will still have a big celebration and a big, you know, kind of exclamation point to their week, but the families will not be attending that dinner and will not have a big giant gathering. The families will check their campers out at their checkout place. At their checkout time. That'll be staggered also, but it'll be a little less time consuming because it's basically just pick the kids up and the luggage up instead of the in-car temperature stuff like that. So there's that. each unit is its own unit. This is the only, not the only photo, but one of the good photos that we got from our fall schools out camps in day camps that we attempted. So look, it's Camp Bethel campers being safe with masks on out in the woods. You'll see this photo a lot this year. That unit autonomy means that unit of counselors and campers will truly be like true small group camping, purest small group camping, and that group will not be interacting directly with other units and will not be participating in big cram packed all camp activities. Now you say, what about a unit passing another unit? Well, there's going to be a 10-foot rule. And yes, a unit can stop and talk to another unit at a distance. And we'll see other people around. It's not like they're going to be, you know, oh, we can't, you know, be within sight of another group. No, it'll be done in a good way. And we do also intend to figure out how to do outdoor group singing after meals. Spread out really far, each unit spread out from other units, and then using we're hoping to get a couple portable battery powered. We already have a couple, but they're not the best for outdoors and they're kind of expensive and we don't want to have to lug them everywhere, but some portable battery powered outdoor kind of loudspeaker things that you can plug a guitar into and also have a microphone into to lead outdoor group singing, each unit distance from the other unit and each camper distance from the other camper. So if you think about at the dining hall, at the lawn, you know, kind of this big gigantic circle of, you know, people in the middle leading, a couple people in the middle leading, and then, you know, around the outskirts, these spread out units, each unit spread out from the other unit. Same thing for worship. One or two corporate or all camp worships during the week. I like to worship out in the field, the big open starry sky, sitting in the grass or on a towel around a campfire. Same thing. It'll just be a bigger space for the ability to do that. So that's this idea of unit autonomy. Equipment and such, we've talked about, you know, sanitize before and after each use, outdoors as much as possible. And then we'll talk a little about the mask wearing. Face masks, again, this is based on what we know right now and could potentially loosen, but probably won't. But face masks are going to be required inside and outside. Inside, except for eating, sleeping, and showering. So indoors is a lot more of a risk for the particles and the breathing, the aerosols. Outside, except when swimming, and then when you're able to be 6 feet from others. A good example is, okay, you're going on a hike up through Horseshoe Bend to Black Horse Gap, okay, the big hike that a lot of the units take. You know, and it's July, and it's 94 degrees with 1,000% humidity, you know, and the unit has chosen unwisely to start their hike at 1 o'clock in the afternoon. All right. You know, if they're spread out and not like right on top of each other, they don't have to wear their mask. But if they gather up at the top for, you know, a prayer or for a group game or something where they're going to be closer to each other, they do need to put their masks on. Okay. So we did hear, and there's some concern, but we heard from this Tracy Gaslin, the doctor from the Camp Nurse Association. She's from Texas, okay, and she's like, don't tell me about heat and humidity. These kids had camp in Texas last summer in 99 degree heat and 1,000% humidity, and they wore masks, and everybody was just fine. So we'll be careful, and we'll monitor and such. Unfortunately, face masks have became politicized and are once again politicized just recently this week. So we want to avoid that. This is also known by families prior to signing up. And we probably, Jenna, need to do a better job of making sure that a lot of our information, now that we've kind of finalized more of a working health plan, to get that out in front of folks so that they know what they're signing up for when they sign up. Physical distancing of 6 to 10 feet as much as possible at all times, and then minimum of 10 feet between units at the limited all camp events. A lot of enhanced cleaning and sanitation, you know, hand sanitizer stations at every entrance and exit. I hope to build a more attractive and more useful and more spread out outdoor hand washing kind of trough, or a couple of them near the dining hall, so we're not having to pack into bathrooms or be right on top of each other doing that. So that's something that has to be either built or bought or borrowed or figured out prior to. If you've seen our outdoor hand washing during the summer, we've just taken like some old utility sinks that we had and hooked them up to a garden hose and stuck them over top of the old RV septic drains in beside the dining hall. And you got to stuff like a towel in the septic drain or else the septic smell comes up. So we're hoping to maybe have something a little more permanent and maybe even like a little sort of a low to the ground, like 3-inch sort of deck that you step up onto and with foot controls for hand washing. I have this dream in my head. I know it probably won't become a reality, but if anybody's really crafty and has a lot of time on their hands, any retirees who are really good at things, please send them my way. And much, much, much more. And I could have done a whole lot of slides, and I could have done a whole slide about meals, how we're going to do food service. We're still debating and we're still kind of learning from other places about what's possible. Our first inclination, and still is to do is eat outside as much as possible. But then in terms of how that works in bad weather, you know, we were thinking, okay, we'll build these shelters. We'll, you know, it was too much. So we're thinking about, okay, if we only have 8 units, then maybe we can do staggered meals. So 4 units in the dining room, eating at only their tables, everybody spread out, windows and doors open, ventilation going well, we can potentially do staggered meals. And so we're working closely with Wes and him thinking through kind of how things could be in both scenarios. We're planning additional, you know, there's going to be a hefty amount of extra staff training, which in that sense, it kind of helps that we're not doing a parent-child overnight camp, because we're going to be using that time with a lot more staff training sessions. The staff will have a healthy behavior agreement for their off-duty times. We are not requiring our staff to remain on site during their off-duty time on weekends, but we are requiring them to agree to a healthy behavior agreement and not, you know, pack into a car with their college buddies and go, you know, to Panther Falls on the weekend without wearing masks and whatever. We are going to have enhanced healthcare on site, and we're figuring out kind of ways that we can do that instead of everybody, you know, showing up at the retreat center for bedtime meds. The bedtime meds will come to the cabin. Communications and process and protocol, if and when we have symptomatic people or COVID positive group or person, the ventilation, the box fan air filters. I'm going to show you my box fan air filters. Get buying and get busy, because I got to build like 50 of these things before the summer. Ways to improve ventilation in lodging spaces, because that's kind of the big worry, is in the lodging spaces, how do we improve ventilation? You know that our cabins have these attic fans that you turn them on and you might as well have a train rumbling beside your cabin. The whole building shakes. You know what? Camp Bethel shakes when one attic fan is turned on. Those things are like, it's like the roar of a jet engine. And I'm not kidding. I'm not kidding about that. I am exaggerating a little bit. Okay. I'll show you box fan air filters in just a second. Transportation, you know, where we would sometimes say, okay, these are the 5 kids from 3 different units who signed up for tubing, so they're going to get in this van, and that's not going to happen this year. We're figuring out different things. The activity modifications, like, you know, how do you have the pool? So we're going to be, you know, adapting that, and then all the things that we have to buy, borrow, or build before June. And that list keeps growing. And so I get a little worried. And so we'll see what happens. If you have any questions specifically, this is my favorite slide of all, any questions specifically about our health plan, there is only one human to contact. I'm just kidding. But Jenna has opened herself up since she has been kind of the lead. Jenna took the lead on our health plan. Okay. And is the one who kind of has adapted it and continues to adapt it, and is doing all the research and studying and watching all the webinars and reading the ACA field guide cover to cover, which was a task in itself. And so contact Jenna. And thank you, Jenna, for that. But we, you know, all of us can answer some questions. Then if we can't, we'll send you to Jenna. So, so these slides are on our website to give you or to give families, you know, kind of a general outline of what to expect. And it will continue to adapt and update, just so you know. Okay. All right. Okay. Stop the share. Jenna, are there any COVID-19 health plan questions? While I get the image of the DIY box fan up and ready. Questions that would be good for the whole everybody.
Yeah. Good. Thank you. So the questions include about masks and also about what we need. We will have plenty of masks on hand for our campers and our counselors, because we know when you're out and about and you're playing that your mask is going to get wet or it might get muddy or, you know, something may happen where you don't want to put that back on your face. So we have plenty on standby, and we will also ask our counselors and our campers to bring extras. There are guidelines to wash things if necessary. That gets a little weird, but we're willing and available to do that on a case-by-case basis. It'd be a little weird to wash single masks at one time. It's a lot of water for a dish or a laundry machine, but and also Barry will soon get to our wish list and our Amazon wish list, where it'll list all of the needs to build the box fans and the other supplies that we'll need to be able to run camp on a COVID safe basis, and that comes at a little later, so we'll get there, just you wait.
Yeah, so let's take a look at the box fan. There's a link in the camp reps web page that links to this video. You can also just do a YouTube search, but this is how to make a DIY air filter. And I'll just kind of I don't think you can hear them, but what they've got is they've got 4 2-inch MERV 13 air filters made in a box. The bottom of that thing is just a piece of cardboard taped to it. And then they're taking a window unit box fan and just securing that box fan and talking to each other about how excited they are about this thing. And then it sits on a floor and then it blows up. So the filters are on the suction side or the intake side of the fan. And then it can sit in the center of a room, and it does an incredible job of being able to filter that filter the air within a room. I would like two of these in every every cabin, in every sleeping area, in every sleeping room this summer. So if you think about that, it starts to add up. I would also like a couple in the kitchen for the kitchen staff, who will be wearing masks, but will be in close proximity with each other. So in our wish list, it just says 20-inch box fans, 2-inch MERV 13, 20x20x2 MERV 13 filters, duct tape, some weather stripping. We can also do a few window mounted ones where they'll be like mounted in the windows. But you don't ever, I don't want a situation where like there's only one mounted in a window and like there's a kid who sleeps near that window. And so all the air kind of moves over that one kid, you get what I'm saying? So we kind of have to space it out and figure out what we can do do for that. Okay, exciting. I'm so excited to start building. I don't know where we're going to store these things if I have to build like 40 of them or 50 of them. Jenna, you got a big living room in the front of that house where you live. Can we, how many cubic feet is it? Okay, we are well past the ability to take a quick break. So we're just going to bust through and we'll be done at 11:30. Can I get a thumbs up from everybody about that, from your reactions or your own thumb? Okay. All right. There we go. Thank you very much. Getting back to our camp rep page, And I'll do the screen share here. Sorry, it takes me a little while. We're going to talk quickly about our upcoming events and the fundraisers that we're having. Again, this is on your on the Camp Reps webpage, and all there will be printed forms of all these. All this information will be within your packet that you get, and it'll also be in our news information and everything that goes out in a big mailer. We're doing a Mother's Day desserts sale. We shifted this past December. We couldn't have our Christmas Together banquet, so Jenna and Spencer and especially Wes got creative and did Christmas desserts, and that was very popular. It was a lot of goodwill, and it was very Christmassy and very fun. This time we're doing it for Mother's Day, but we're doing it like there's only gonna be one pickup day, and that's Friday before Mother's Day. And so get your Mother's Day desserts in. The profits from that are gonna go one half toward our campership program and one half toward like the general camp budget. And this is in place of a Sow the Seed banquet, because usually we would have a Sow the Seed scholarship banquet, which usually brings in about $8,000 every March, and we can't do it this year. So instead, we're doing this Mother's Day desserts sale. Yeah, go ahead, Jenna.
There will also be another pickup day at in the Oak Grove parking lot, which is similar to what we did for the Christmas dessert tins as well. So on the Thursday before Mother's Day, we'll be, or it might also be the Friday, but we'll be at the Oak Grove parking lot. So two pickup options.
I'm pretty sure it was just Friday at camp, like 10 to 4, and then at Oak Grove from like 5 to 7 is the plan. So whatever that, the Friday before Mother's Day. Mother's Day is, I think, May 9th. Is that correct? Anyway, I don't have my calendar open, but you get it. Okay. Spread the word. Spring volunteer work day will happen. We did have a fall volunteer work day with grab and go meals and kind of kept everybody safe. So we do want to make sure that that you know that we are having that. You do have to register in advance, and it's if you click that or if you are on our events page, it takes you to it. Our Camp Bethel Pep 5K is set for September 4th. That's Labor Day weekend, which worked out really great. We're seeking sponsors for that. We would love to have additional sponsors, because sponsors is really where it's at for having a fundraiser make some money for us. So we're excited to do that again. That'll be the fifth annual, I believe, and we're pushing for about 180 participants if we can. Sounds of the Mountains is happening online again. There's just no way that we can be ready and that people are comfortable yet. So the Sounds of the Mountains, this is our 20th annual Sounds of the Mountains festival. The first one was 2002, so this is number 20. It's not the 20th anniversary, it's the 20th. But we've got, because it was our 20th event, we had already pre-booked like the best lineup we've ever had. All headliners, six of them: Donald Davis, Bill Lepp, Kevin Kling, Barbara McBride Smith, Dolores Hydock, Donna Washington. So that's all going to be on soundsofthemountains.org. It'll be a video format, but it'll be different than what we had last year. Instead of five kind of big shows, it's going to be done where each performer has their own page, and then there'll be the stories, individual stories that you can watch of each performer. We've had some, anyway, it might work, it might not, but anyway, we'll be encouraging people to donate. It'll be for free again, with donations accepted. And again, that's its own website, soundsofthemountains.org. Okay. All right. Golf tournament again, September 22nd, worked really good. And Heritage Day information is coming soon. Okay. All right. That leads us into our current needs, projects, and opportunities. We continue to need donations, monetary donations, to help us survive. And so all of you are going to get another letter. Please don't throw it in the trash. Look at it. maybe feel a little guilty or pass that guilt on to somebody else. We do have an Amazon wish list, and it is in the footer of all of our emails, and it's in the footer of our website. If you go all the way down to any page on our entire website, there's the Amazon wish list. Now, look, we're not talking about the politics of Amazon. Look, I get it. Yeah, Jeff Bezos, trillionaire, you know, not fair, boo. Amazon doesn't treat its workers right, whatever, but it's just kind of the tool we have right now to get what we need. And so we do have an Amazon wish list, which has all the box fan filters and the box fans and the more hand sanitizer and more face masks and disinfectant spray and Clorox wipes and like, and then more stuff. And then actually some fun stuff like, you know, balls and, you know, a little karaoke and a speaker for a loudspeaker for singing, like things like that. One quick exciting thing that is happening has yet to sort of formalize is that the Verlina District Disaster Response Committee has agreed and has sort of partnered with us for some projects for some work, and we're gonna hopefully build a new adventure village before this summer happens. We're going to add a deck to the newly remodeled Bandage Box Cottage. And then also, with help from Stotsburg Engineering and the Roanoke Disc Golf Club, we're building a Camp Bethel disc golf course up in the woods in our adventure forest. So a lot of great opportunities for volunteering, and hopefully we'll be able to make a little more formal announcement about how you can get involved. But April 3rd, spring volunteer work to April 3rd, the Verlina District disaster folks are going to be here kind of talking about what they're able to do and sort of recruiting and kind of, you know, meshing the good volunteers of Camp Bethel in with some of that ways that we can help things get ready. The best piece of paper that you can have that sort of has all the information that we've talked about all morning long is our spring news. And it's right here, and I'm going to click on it. It's our spring little news page, and it's very text heavy, but it's a two pager. It's got kind of everything we've talked about, not in great detail on any of it, but it kind of, you know, shows everything there. Okay. This is a great piece to have, and this will be included in everybody's mailer that you get come in a week or more. Okay. And then we'll have our packets, and there'll be copies of this within the packet. It'll probably be, you know, April, May, or May, June news by then. Okay. Questions.
So Susan asked if there would be a children's section available within the Sounds of the Mountains videos. I actually just looked that up, and yes, there will be a children's section. Am I wrong, Barry?
Yeah, we're going to do every teller has been contracted, if you will, to do at least one children's story. And so there will be a separate children's page with all of the children's stories in one place. Which will probably be the place, let's be honest, that all of us will watch first. Okay, so.
Outside of that, unless there are questions that folks have that I didn't see in the chat or haven't been able to address, I think we did it.
Well, and everyone, please know that you can individually ask questions. Email is the easiest for us because it doesn't catch us off guard in the middle of something else. But, you know, you can call us, you can email us. We're ready. As you know, we live and breathe this pretty much all day, every day. So we're prepared for it. Oh, I see Jenny's dog there hogging all the attention. Jenny Waring has started a GoFundMe, where we both kind of did our first GoFundMe attempt. We kind of learned as we went, but there's a GoFundMe on our Facebook and on Jenny's Facebook, where she's raising some money for scholarships and for some other things. So her goal is $1,000. So help Jenny or share that fundraiser. If you go to our Facebook, if you do that kind of thing, thank you, Jenny, for taking the initiative on that. It's past 11:30, so I want to honor your time, but I also want to be able to let you ask questions, but certainly, email, phone. I appreciate each of you taking the time this morning. An hour and a half went really fast for me. I know it didn't go fast for you, and I apologize for that. There's a lot more we could have spent time talking about. Like, I want you to look at the little draw-up plans for the Adventure Village, too. We're really excited about that. After years of having adventure villages, we now have taken all the feedback from our counselors and campers on what would be the best adventure village possible, space-wise, overhang, coverage-wise. And so we think we've designed it. And just so you hear this too, those of you who are still hanging around, we weren't spending that money frivolously. You may or may not have heard that my mother passed away back on December 5th. And the family chose donations to Camp Bethel. Well, you know, when someone passes and the memorial is supposed to come to camp, you might get, you know, $75, $150 or so. We got over $6,000 came in. Wow. And so we were like, okay, so let's do something permanent with that. And typically when we have memorial gifts that are larger like that, we do something capital. And my mother was real fond of our adventure program, and my dad helped build the original Adventure Village. And so that money is going to that, in addition to some of the other construction things too. So, and the good folks at Daleville had given money last year, and that money's being used for Daleville Cabin. And then some of it's for some lumber here, there, and everywhere else too. So we've had some really good help with memorial gifts. And I'm also happy to report that we just received yesterday in the mail an $8,000 gift from a good family, and saying we know you need it right now, and boy do we ever. So very helpful, very positive. It feels like we're winning. I don't play the lottery, I don't gamble, but I sort of feel like I should this weekend, because guess what else happened? I pre-registered for the COVID vaccine, and they've now identified camp staff as out of school childcare through the CDC. And I updated my thing on Thursday. I had pre-registered a couple weeks ago. And within an hour, I got that email saying, here's the appointments, because, you know, they got the big Johnson & Johnson influx. So tomorrow morning at 10:15, Barry Lenore, I feel kind of guilty, but, you know, we need to get it when we can. I'm going to get vaccinated. And so it's exciting. So I hope all of you can, if you haven't. So. Okay, well, we're going to close this thing out, or let you hang around. You can turn off your mute and holler at somebody if you want to, but we're officially done. Send us your questions, your comments, your needs. If there's anything that wasn't real clear or that you disagree with, we want to hear it. Okay? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you, Barry.
Thank you, Barry.
And happy wedding shower at Eden First for Hannah Oaks. A drive-through wedding shower. Was her childhood dream to have a drive-through wedding shower, I'm sure. So y'all are welcome to leave or hang around. Me and Jenna and Spencer will stay here. But thank you for attending. Thank you, Sam. Oh, Sam's gone. They're all gone now. Okay. What do you think? We all right? Sorry, I didn't let y'all talk any, but I think it worked
out.
Okay.
Fine.
Oh, I'm still recording. I need to hit stop recording. Well, I'll edit that out. So, ready to stop recording.